This is a presentation of the Center for Advanced Study at the University of Illinois. For over 50 years, the Center for Advanced Study has brought together scholars from diverse disciplines and backgrounds, encouraging and rewarding excellence in all areas of academic inquiry at Illinois, one of the nation's premier public universities. For more information about this presentation and other center activities, please visit cas.illinois.edu.
It gives me great pleasure to introduce Terence Ranger to the University of Illinois. Not your first trip here, I believe. I think your third, if I'm correct. As with many in that first generation of post-war professional historians of Africa, Ranger came to the subject in a rather roundabout way. He completed a doctorate in colonial Irish history at Oxford, after which he joined the faculty of what was then the University College of Rhodesia in Nyasaland, where he remade himself a historian of Africa and became active in the emerging nationalist political struggle in the future Zimbabwe. In 1963, he was expelled and left Rhodesia for Tanzania, where he shifted his focus to the development of a strong history department at the University of Dar es Salaam. Here, both he and the department became associated with placing African initiative or African agency at the front on historical research. This was borne out in his 1967 publication, Revolt in Southern Rhodesia, as well as in the subsequent several books he has produced, 8 authored or co-authored monographs, 17 edited or co-edited collections, and 150-odd articles and book chapters. He's perhaps best known to non-Africanists for The Invention of Tradition, a volume which he co-edited with Eric Hobsbawm. Ranger's most recent publication is Bulawayo Burning, A Social History of an African City, for which there will be a book launch tomorrow at 12:30 at Temple Beale Hall, and to which you are all cordially invited, for sale at half price. Terence Ranger has taught at a number of subsequent universities since leaving Dar es Salaam in 1969, including UCLA, University of Manchester, and eventually Oxford University. After retiring from Oxford, he returned to the University of Zimbabwe for 3 productive, if rather tumultuous, years before finally returning to Oxford in 2001. There he remains today, living the life of a most productive emeritus professor. Now, I won't attempt to summarize his influence, his productivity, or his generosity, all of which are just remarkable. Suffice to say that he has led the career of both a first-rate academic and a first-rate political activist. I will conclude by saying that as a historian of Africa, Terence Ranger has not only pursued this career-long commitment to trace African agency, but also to identify African institutions that are often obscured or invisible to those who rely on colonial archives. Such institutions, be it witchcraft eradication movements in Tanzania, dance societies in East Africa, or mediumships and shrines in Zimbabwe, more easily catch the eye of anthropologists rather than historians. But these semi-visible or sometimes invisible institutions have consistently caught Ranger's eye. And in response, he has done the work of historicizing these institutions, which in his books do not exist as static ethnographic structure, but have specific historical trajectories with beginnings and an end. So I and many other Africanists find consistent inspiration and guidance not only to look for African agency, but also to look for it in those institutions that do not neatly correspond to Western social structures, but do in fact loom large in the daily lives of Africans. And with this in mind, I ask you to please warmly welcome Terence Ranger, the George A. Miller Visiting Professor, who will give our Center for Advanced Study Millercom lecture today, From Spirit to Body, Approaches to Violence and Memory in Zimbabwe.
Well, I'm glad that the title of the next Miller lecture is even more impenetrable than mine. I'm here this week. I have been to this campus twice before, but I'm here this week to attend a workshop which is evaluating my work over the last 45 years. And one topic which I've persistently treated during that time has been the topic of African and, in particular, Zimbabwean religion. So this lecture tonight, as well as fitting, I hope, into the history department's interest in the body, also fits very well into the workshop, which began today and will be concluded tomorrow. Now, the lecture is called From Spirit to Body. And I want to begin by emphasizing that in my definitions of African religion and my treatment of African religion in Zimbabwe, I have always emphasized the centrality of spirit and spirit possession. We watched, those of us at the workshop, a rather frustrating film at lunch, which spent 15 minutes on the preliminaries to spirit possession and ended before any spirit possessed anybody. But nevertheless, spirits are going to be moving in this amphitheater tonight. In 1988, I contributed an essay to a huge collection on the world's religions, and my essay was on African traditional religion. And in that essay, as well as trying to emphasize the dynamism of African traditional religion and the scale of it, so I was trying to attack the idea that Africa is made up of hundreds of so-called tribal religions, I also defined African religion in terms of relationships. There were many different relationships, I wrote, between people, relationships with kin and neighbors, but also relationships with other hunters or traders or pilgrims. There were relationships with the cultivated land, but also with the hunting bush and the forests. And African religious ideas were very much ideas about relationships with other living people or with the spirits of the dead or with animals or with cleared land or with the bush. And in many parts of Africa, and certainly in Zimbabwe, all such relationships were thought of in terms of relationships with spirits. Spirits of ancestors, spirits of the land or the water, spirits of dead foreigners. The idiom of spirit was an idiom of personification, dramatizing the personal rather than the merely metaphorical content of relationships. And all these spirits, in Zimbabwe at any rate, could manifest themselves by taking possession of living men or women. Very often the pattern was an affliction, an illness, search for a cure, and the cure achieved by coming to terms with the spirit that wishes to possess you. And that could be achieved in almost all kinds of relationship, unless it was a witch spirit that wanted to possess you, in which case you could not be cured. Or at least you couldn't be cured until the idea of exorcism came in. I argued in this piece that the idea of relationship, spirit, and possession, quote, helped to make possible ordered interactions between people and helped to establish codes of conduct, whether ecological rules for human beings' relationship with the environment, or rules of inheritance, or codes of communication between strangers, or explanations of misfortune. But in addition to this functionalism, the idea of spirit possession makes things work, it also allowed speculation about the nature of good and evil. And there were plenty of room for divinities as well as for personifying spirits. And the remaining pages of my account in that publication were, as I've said before, attempts to relate this system of possession and explanation to historical change. The exploring attempts by African kingdoms, for example, to control or to repress spirit by trying to centralize, monopolize ancestor veneration by suppressing rain chimes dedicated to God or turning their custodians into senior bureaucrats, by absorbing nature spirits into royal genealogies, and sometimes by executing prophets and spirit mediums. But although states, both pre-colonial states and modern African nation states, although states desire to control spirit, there's always the idea, the possibility, the actuality of the relative autonomy of spirit. The idea that the spirit bloweth where it listeth. Possession, can give to a man or woman a sort of poetic license. If a possessed medium utters seditious words, those words can always be explained as the work of the spirit rather than of its unconscious host. And the idiom is that the medium doesn't know what he or she is saying when they're in a state of possession. Spirits could empower people as prophets, responding to public opinion, freeing them from the control of priests or chiefs. If a medium was killed, the spirit could seize upon somebody else. And ultimately, spirit could be not boxed up or trapped. I've written about the Matopo Hills, southwest of Bulawayo in Zimbabwe. I should say that I've never given a lecture with a laptop presentation. My granddaughters keep on saying to me, let us make you a laptop presentation. But I've gone beyond that. But if I'd been going to have a laptop presentation tonight, I would have shown you the Matopo Hills. So you just have to imagine. Look me in the eye and imagine the most extraordinary landscape. My youngest daughter says it's the only place where she ever thought there might be a god. And Africans believe that God does indeed speak in cave shrines in the Matopos Hills. I've heard myself the voice of God emerging from cave shrines in the Matopos. Eerie, high, the voice of women possessed by divinity. And when the World Council of Churches came to meet in Harare, and I went to a session where an Afrikaner academic was talking about the internal concept of African religion and the lack of voice, I challenged the audience to come with me in a chartered bus and hear the voice of God for themselves. But the prospect was a bit frightening for the World Council of Churches, and we didn't go. But there in those cave shrines, one can hear the voice of God, and there is indeed an academic, Martinus Daniil of Boston, who last time he was there actually was allowed to take a tape recorder into the cave. I don't know how he got away with it, but he did, and he tape recorded several what he calls sermons by the voice of God. He says he's going to produce a book of practical theology based on his tape recordings of the voice of God. I didn't dare to do that. But I have talked to the priests, talked to the women who are possessed by the voice of God, and in particular, I've collected the sort of divine history of this cult of the high God. And the divine history is a history rather like the Old Testament in some ways, of the supremacy of spirit. each successive political regime is explained by the cult in terms of the favor of God, Mwali, or in terms of the withdrawal of that favor, where the rulers affront God and are doomed then to be replaced. Many states have based themselves close to the Metopos, but no state has been able to control these shrines completely. And one of the master stories of the shrines is about the downfall of the Rochwe Mambos. During the workshop today, we heard a good deal about the Rochwe. And the story goes that the Mambo was angered by the rebuke that he heard from the voice of God and sought to silence it. He blocked the cave from which the voice spoke. And so the voice began to speak from the stone walls of his capital. He tore down the walls, and the voice spoke from the trees. He cut down the trees, and the voice spoke from the sky. It can never be silenced. Now, I've perhaps too much emphasized in my own work over the years the extent to which the idiom of spirit offers protection against power. The current deputy prime minister in Zimbabwe, Arthur Mutambara, was a robotics student in Oxford. In an enlightened kind of way, for a robot, he used to come to my seminars, my history seminars. And he would get quite angry. "Why are you so pleased," he asked me, "that Zimbabweans believe in spirits? You don't believe in Mwali yourself, or the vengeful Ngozi spirits of the unjustly killed. So why do you think that such nonsense is good enough for ignorant Africans?" He doesn't say things like that as Deputy Prime Minister, of course. Even a robotics man has more sense than that. I tried to explain to him that I didn't believe in these things, but that I approved of them because they were constraints on the power of the state. And the belief in the Ngozi spirit of the unjustly killed and its power to punish the killer is a restraint on murderous men who can be driven crazy. Murderous women too, I don't wish to be sexist. Who can be driven crazy by their fear of the vengeance. And in the early 1980s, just after independence, there was much killing in Matabele land in the west of Zimbabwe. And subsequently, the soldiers involved in that killing have been haunted by the fear of Ngozi spirits. Many Zimbabwean novels are about that. The Catholic Commission for Justice and Peace will tell you of the soldiers who come to them and say, "Can you put us in touch with the family or this or that person that we killed?" So these are mechanisms by which the weak can extract some kind of tribute from the strong. Leaving Arthur Mutambara's questions aside, I'm not totally displeased when I revisit this sketch of African religion 20 years later. It's been found useful and cited by other scholars, not only Zimbabwean ones. And a recent account of East African religious history offers a very similar account of the African religion of relationships there. The centrality of spirit forces. So my own view of religion in Zimbabwe has really focused on that, the centrality of spirit forces. But when I reread that sketch and all the other work that I've written, what strikes me now is that there's almost nothing about the corporeal. It's all spirit and no body. And in view of the development of the Zimbabwean academic literature, the theme of this lecture series, and the terms of contemporary discourse in Zimbabwe, it strikes me as odd that nowhere in my account of African religion are to be found the words bones, or graves, or bodies. Of course, I could argue that my account implies bodies. There couldn't be any spirit possession without a body for the spirit to possess. Even the great lion or rain spirits, like Nehanda, the heroine of Zimbabwe, or Chamanuka, whose medium we saw on this unsatisfactory film at lunchtime, even the greatest spirits need a living medium. So that the spirit cannot express itself without a body, although the relationship is often conceptualized in ways which diminishes the body. The body is called the purse into which this treasure of the spirit is poured. And sometimes if the medium is immoral or inadequate, they say the purse is torn, thrown away. The spirit has to find another recipient. No one can become an ancestor spirit in Zimbabwe unless his body, and the masculine pronoun is largely justified in this case, has received a proper funeral. There cannot be ancestors without burials. And during the violence that I referred to in Western Zimbabwe during the 1980s and the guerrilla war of the 1970s, it wasn't only the killing of men that was so terrible, but the dumping of their bodies in mine shafts or mass graves, and the prohibition of mournings and funerals. When men were being deprived not only of their lives, but of their futures as ancestors, so that the recovery of bones and their interment in graves were crucial. Nevertheless, recognizing these corporeal implications doesn't fully instate flesh and bones and graves. As I've said, the purse can be torn and discarded. And as for ancestors, I would have said 20 years ago that the grave is only important for a year after death. A year after death, there is a ceremony called Kuroa Goa in Shona, where the spirit is brought back to rest, where the widow can remarry, where the possessions of the dead man are distributed, where people no longer fear the vengeance of the spirit which has become an ancestor. And even now today, in December 2009, for example, there was a debate in Bulawayo about the bad state of the city's cemeteries. Why were the graves in such disrepair? And the great historian of Western Zimbabwe, Patisa Inyati, wrote in the paper, "The graves neglected by families are, from an African perspective, graves given precedence only in the first year after death. Culturally, the grave is given precedence for the first 12 months after burial, but then the ceremony brings back the spirit, and after that, graves no longer have importance. So 12 months after death, body is replaced by spirit." Now, I've drawn upon this spiritual understanding of Zimbabwean religion in all my writings about violence and history in Zimbabwe. 43 years ago, my first book, Revolt in Southern Rhodesia, notoriously and controversially argued that the 1896 uprisings against the British South Africa Company were inspired by the Moali Shrine voices and by the mediums of senior spirits like Haguvi and Nahanda. 40 years ago, my second book, The African Voice in Southern Rhodesia, began with a chapter which recorded reports by colonial intelligence officers about the utterance of mediums. History was still spirit-driven. "I am Chamanuka," said a medium in 1903, speaking with the voice of the great prophet. "I know everything. I'm all powerful. I caused the downfall of the Rojwi and the Matabili, and I will cause the white man to leave this country. Nothing is impossible to me." That's the way to tell them. But it took him some time, but still, that's the way to tell him. Those two books were written and published after I had been evicted from Rhodesia as a prohibited immigrant in 1963. Chair people often introduce me as someone deported by Ian Smith. I always hasten to correct them because any fool could be deported by Ian Smith. I was deported by Sir Roy Walensky, a much rarer distinction. But anyway, I was unable to return to Zimbabwe and carry out research until independence came in 1980. And when I returned, I went east to the Mkoni district in order to explore the interaction of peasants and guerrillas. And in 1985, a book called Peasant Consciousness and Guerrilla Warfare was published. But the first thing I produced after my return to Zimbabwe came in July 1982 in an article called The Death of Chamanuka, Spirit Mediums, Nationalisms, and the Guerrilla War. So I was very much back with the spirit. Now, the film that we saw at lunchtime was a film of the aged Muchatera, medium of the great Chamanuka spirit. Very important man, because drawing upon the authority of the spirit, he had been the informant of the academics who were writing about Shona culture and history in the 1950s and 1960s. He was an inspired inventor of history. He worked with the ethnographer Michael Gelfand and told him how the Chamanuka spirit was next only to God in the spiritual universe. "It is believed," wrote Gelfand, "that all other spirits receive instructions from Chamanuka." Muchatera worked with the linguist and oral historian Donald Abraham and spoke in trance in the voice of the senior spirit to articulate a history of the rise of Shona empires. And of course, it was irresistibly fascinating for a historian to be able to interview a 15th century king in his or your sitting room. Muchatera's family told the musicologist, Paul Berliner, how Chamanuka had introduced the Imbira thumb piano. Shona religion, political culture, music, all derived from Chamanuka in Muchatera's account. Now, paradoxically, these scholars, particularly Abraham and Gelfand, were conservative men, quite unsympathetic to African nationalism. But their work, inspired by this medium, presented a picture of a historic, centralized Shona nation, religion, and culture, which was very attractive to African cultural nationalists. And this picture was part of the background against which I wrote my first book, Revolt in Southern Rhodesia, and from which I derived the spirit emphasis in my studies of African religion. When I came back in the early 1980s, it was already being realized how distorting and manipulative the senior spirit mediums had been, and particularly Muchatera Chamanuka. And ironically, this medium of the Great Spirit had been killed on the 31st of January 1977 and he was killed by Zanla guerrillas, guerrillas of Mugabe's force. That guerrilla force said it was fighting in the name of the ancestor spirits and of Nahanda and Chamanuka, but they brought in a rocket launcher from Mozambique. They rocketed Muchatera's spirit hut and shot him down, saying he said he could not be killed. Look at him now. He obviously was not Chamanuka. And so I wrote about the death of that Chamanuka medium and about the way in which his influence on scholars had produced this extraordinary centralized picture of the Shona past. The guerrillas in the Makoni district where the shooting took place went on to work with the other spirit mediums. And one of those other spirit mediums said to me, the boys obeyed the spirits. Things were quite perfect then, and the spirits protected the boys. My Peasant Consciousness and Guerrilla War was one of the first two books to be published by James Carey in what is now his famous series of African studies. The other was another book about Rhodesia and the war, David Land's remarkable Guns and Rain. What a title, it's a marvelous title. Guns and Rain, Guerrillas and Spirit Mediums in Zimbabwe. And Land's book swept all before it. I had to persuade James Curry to publish his esoteric work of anthropology, but in fact it was a bestseller. It was hailed by anthropologists as saving the discipline. Here you have a work of rigorous structuralism, which at the same time can tell you about a guerrilla war. And with enormous panache, and David Land has gone on not to be an academic, but to be a playwright and a producer, with enormous panache, it reconstructed the war and the importance to it of the spirit mediums. In his doctoral thesis, David Land had completely destroyed the kind of oral history that someone like Donald Abraham had carried out, showing that when the spirit mediums gave genealogies of dead kings, that those were living, moving, changing statements of relationships rather than genealogies of the past, so that a spirit medium could build in as a son or daughter of a dead king a new medium who had become significant in the last 10 years. But they were masters of history, Lan argued, and they were able to offer to the young guerrillas a place in the history of the district. These young guerrillas came in not under their own names, but under pseudonyms. They call themselves Black Jesus or Uriah Heep. I thought, gosh, that's a well-read guerrilla, but there turns out to be a rock band of some sort after which he'd named himself. Or Dracula. And I talked to a headmaster living in an area very much affected by guerrillas during the guerrilla war, and his wife described how there was a thunderous knock on their door, and she went to open it, and she said to her husband, oh, don't worry, darling, it's only Dracula. So these guerrillas, because the guerrilla armies didn't want them to establish relationships with kin. Normally in Zimbabwe, after 10 minutes, you've established where somebody is in relationship to all your relatives. You can't do that with Dracula or even with Uriah Heep. So they were strangers. And the Rhodesian government said that they were animals. Catch them with their pants down and you'll see that they have tails. And so the stories always go, the guerrillas called us out into the bush and they said, do we have tails? And then you say cautiously, not so far as I can see, and so on. And gradually, you discover that they don't. But what Lan was arguing was that the spirit mediums were able to insert these strange young men into a position akin to that of ancestors. They became the soldiers of spirit. They incorporated them into senior status positions. They imposed certain kinds of spiritual obligations upon the guerrillas. They imposed the obligation, for example, to kill witches. And never before David Land's book had the spirit direction of African religion and resistance been so strikingly demonstrated. So I remained wedded to spirit and continued to publish on the same lines, but in more detail, as we learnt more. And what struck me most in the post-independence period was this question of the relative autonomy of spirit. The new rulers might say that their revolution had been blessed by the spirits, by the great Chamanuka or the great Nahanda. But on the ground, they had continuous trouble with the mediums of those spirits. Now, many, many Zimbabweans have forgotten this, most. But in 1982, a medium of the great Nahanda spirit, based near the Zimbabwe ruins, was arrested by the field force, taken to Salisbury and put on trial for incitement to murder. She had told the guerrillas to get their guns again and to continue to attack the white farmers. Mugabe is just a puppet of the whites, she said. Nothing has changed. The whites are still in charge of the land. And when she was interrogated by an ex-Rhodesian policeman and tried by an ex-Rhodesian judge who refused to allow her to wear her spirit uniform in court, it became clear to her that she was right. Mugabe was a puppet. She was sentenced to death. As they say, not many people know that. Not many people, Zimbabweans, can imagine an Ahanda medium sentenced to death in 1982. She wasn't, in fact, executed. She was pardoned and is back again at Great Zimbabwe. But still, it was a dramatic instance of the clash between the new state and the new state, which had been saying our revolution was blessed by Nahanda, the medium killed in 1897, prophesied that her bones would rise again and the guerrillas are her bones. Now they were saying, Nahanda didn't make us, we made Nahanda. Why are there so many Nahanda mediums? It's because we say they're important. And it's intolerable that they should decide whether it's peace or war. Mugabe was caught in the contradiction whereby at one and the same time he was saying that in the 19th century, the Nahanda medium had decided when it was peace or war, but now they couldn't possibly do so. Powerful mediums after 1980 declared that the new state had not healed its armies or cleansed the land of blood. They demanded huge spirit rituals, none of which have taken place. When the new modernizing government tried to impose colonial-type resettlement schemes in the Dandi Valley that Land wrote about, spirit mediums denounced these agrarian policies just as they had denounced those of the Rhodesian state. When Mugabe's government surrounded and handed a medium in Chinoy with a CIO bodyguard, popular demand on the ground generated a new Nahanda medium to represent the people against the state. And so the relative autonomy of spirit still continued. What government tried to do was to organize these mediums into a state-controlled organization, ZINATA, the Zimbabwe National Traditional Healers Association. And the certificate for being a traditional healer bears a photograph of Nahanda and of Kagubi, but no mediums belong to it. all mediums have refused to join Zenata, which is, they say, just an organization for healers. Mediums are not healers. Mediums are prophets. They refused to join this bureaucratically structured national organization. In August 1987, four spirit mediums wrote to register their discontent with Zenata. You direct that any traditional healer must register clinics with the traditional medical council. But we maintain as a matter of right that we are free to travel anywhere. We're guided in everything we do by our spirits. We're bound by tradition and law to obey our spirits. Your directive conflicts with their directives. This may be due to the fact that most of you are ordinary herbalists who do not know spirit. So you can see that the new state and its institutions, even those institutions which were trying to make use of African tradition, found themselves clashing with the autonomy of spirit. In the 1980s, I moved my research from Eastern Zimbabwe to Western Zimbabwe. I wanted to discover what had happened in Matabele land, and I entered the zone of those high god shrines. And they were still operating, still predicting the rise and fall of regimes, still extending full spiritual support to Joshua Nkomo against the attacks of Mugabe and his men, still sending out female prophetesses, roaming through the southern half of Zimbabwe, challenging businesses, churches, traditional power, and criticizing the new state for its failure to respect the spirits. So right through my own work, rising to its climax with my book, Voices from the Rocks, in 1999, I drew on more and more evidence of the dominance of spirit in Zimbabwean religion. And yet, by 2000, there was much more discourse in Zimbabwe about the body than there was discourse about the spirit. Bones were being exhumed, graves were being constructed and refurbished, the corpses of prominent spirit mediums were being searched for, the relative autonomy of the spirit, its elusiveness, seems to be giving way to materiality. That's why I call this lecture From Spirit to Body. Now, this is partly, perhaps, a reflection of the development of academic fashion, development of academic theory. In 2006, Tabona Shoko published a paper, a member of the Religious Studies Department at the University of Zimbabwe, published a paper called My Bones Shall Rise Again, War Veteran Spirits and Land Reforms in Zimbabwe. And in that paper, he emphasized the key significance of reburial. And he asked, to what extent do dead bones affect political ideology? What is the effect of the body politic on the nation, surviving relatives and leadership? And whereas I focused and Lan focused on mediums and spirits, he focuses on bodies. And he describes in great detail the rituals by that time underway in Zimbabwe for reburial. Now, it's true that in his description, spirit mediums are present, helping to locate mass graves. He describes mass graves found in the north of the country and the excavation, exhumation of the remains and their reburial. And he goes on to describe the work of National Museums and Monuments and of his curator of Militaria, retired Lieutenant Colonel Edgar Nkwani, in identifying sites, erecting memorial shrines, and site museums. For the museum, the crucial activity was the creation of monuments, making the graves permanent and the bodies within them the lasting symbols of liberation and of the right to land. Museums were not concerned to carry out the ceremony a year after death, which transforms people into ancestors. And Choco says, by doing this, the government manipulates traditional beliefs. Dead bodies have certain properties that make them symbols. Dead bodies don't speak, but words can be put into their mouths. Dead bodies provide a curriculum vitae or resume upon which people can rewrite history. The aura of sanctity presented by the corpses and reburials sacralizes the political order. Choco was the first person to write in this way, but the centrality of bodies had long been apparent. After all, ZANU-PF had created and still dominates the Hero's Acre in Harare, which had been analyzed by several academics. Mugabe every year speaks to the buried heroes in Hero's Acre as ancestors, although no rituals have been carried out for them. And many graves in Hero's Acre don't possess the bodies. Chief Tangwena, for example, his grave at Hero's Acre is filled with rocks, and he himself is buried with his predecessor chiefs. The mausoleum, Hero's Acre, represents the material, not the spirit. And this is particularly clear with the statue of the unknown soldier. On the 18th of August 2006, the Herald newspaper included a long piece by an ex-combatant, Brooks Chinimbiri, describing how on March 26, 1975, the young Job left Highfield Township to join the Zana Army in Mozambique, how he was sent to military training in Tanzania and then deployed as a guerrilla back into the Shingo province. To get there, the group had to pass through Gonerezu National Park. Their guide lost his way. They spent 2 days without food or water. Then they found a small stream and rushed to drink. A bull elephant charged forward, crossed the little stream, and ferociously lifted Job with his trunk, powerfully throwing him to the ground and pounding his chest. He died instantly. Somehow, we managed to do what had to be done. We dug two shallow graves with our rifle bayonets and gently laid him to rest with his head facing the east. And the comrades led us in song before covering their bodies with the little earth that was available. Chinimbiri insists that the majority of those who lost relatives during the war don't now know where they are buried. But, he says, at Hero's Acre, there is the tomb of the unknown soldier, the empty tomb of the unknown soldier, which majestically towers, a befitting remembrance of the gallant sons and daughter of Zimbabwe. There you go, if you want to remember Job. An empty tomb, copied, of course, from European and Asian models. Every time I visit the National Hero's Acre, he says, I spend a minute of silence gazing at the gigantic tomb of the unknown soldier. It should be accorded the highest respect in every possible way by all Zimbabweans. So, ex-combatants, the state, Heroes Acre, the Commission of National Monuments and Museums to exhume, all that has been putting tremendous emphasis upon the body. But what's particularly important to emphasize is that some of ZANU's opponents have been equally material and forensic. Sherry Eppel with the Amani Trust has been at the forefront of the campaign to recover bodies of those slain in the 1980s in western Zimbabwe. Some 30,000 people were killed in the 1980s, their bodies thrown down mine shafts or left in the bush. And in the late 1980s, the Imani Trust began painstakingly to identify and recover these bodies. In April 2001, Sherry attended a conference in Berkeley on regional and human rights in the context of DNA. Her paper was entitled Healing the Dead to Transform the Living. And what Sherry Eppel says is that this is a forensic process. She's calling upon the Argentinian experience, groups of Argentinian forensic anthropologists have visited Zimbabwe to help identify and exhume. And she told the Barclay Radio, to deny that people have been murdered is to deny that they ever lived. It's a kind of complete absence of these people from history. But the bones restore the truth. The bones tell the truth back. So that Sherry Eppel, speaking to the opponents of the Mugabe regime, emphasizes the key significance of bones just as much as the ex-guerrillas and ZANU PF itself. And ZANU intellectuals in the press constantly harp not on the spirit of Nahanda nowadays, but on her bones, the medium of Nahanda who was executed in 1898, prophesied that her bones would arise. These young men now who are the heroes of the revolution, says Professor Mahoso, inherit the bones, genetically descendants from Nahanda. So you begin to have a movement away from the emphasis on the cruciality of spirit and a movement towards exhumation and reburial. And the Movement for Democratic Change has responded in kind, producing a list of its own martyrs, organizing its own exhumations and funerals. As Juice Fontaine writes, it's likely that in future, the unsettled dead of Zimbabwe's most recent violence will return in their demands for reburial, just as the dead guerrillas have returned. And Juice Fontaine, I realize I won't be able to read what I've got written about him, but Juice Fontaine is the most important academic theorist of materiality, of bones, of graves. Young anthropologist who's worked in the area around Great Zimbabwe and who emphasizes the importance of the material. He's founded something rather gruesomely called the Bones Collective at the University of Edinburgh. In December 2008, they organized a research workshop, What Lies Beneath? Exploring the effective presence and emotive materiality of human bones. And to that workshop, Fontaine himself gave a paper about Zimbabwe. the dry bones, the fleshy immateriality of tortured bodies. He asked not only what bones do and what bodies do, and in his subsequent work, he has developed those distinctions. I went to listen to a lecture that he gave to the Royal Anthropological Society, which was all about graves. And the way that graves, well, human beings depend upon graves rather than graves on human beings, he said. The effective presence and emotive materiality of bones doesn't necessarily depend upon belief in spirits. Bones have an agency that's not necessarily related to the consciousness of the dead themselves. So you've got an academic movement, which is not only taking place in Zimbabwe, of course, but is reflected much more widely. An academic movement which is moving from spirit to bones. The question is whether all this, the emphasis on exhumation, the emphasis on hero's acre, the academic emphasis upon bones, the question is whether all this is reflected in wider practice on the ground. When I sent a copy of this lecture to Joost, including the couple of pages with which it finishes and which I'm going to present now, he wrote back to say that he was astonished by this material that I'm now going to present. What he had thought was that he was presenting another way of looking at the same data. He wasn't arguing that bones had become more important. He was arguing, he said, that they'd always been very important. So he was surprised by my saying that I seemed to be able to discover on the ground a move from spirit to bones. Let's see what you think about it. In July 2010, the Sunday Mail, which is one of the state newspapers, carried a story about Mugabe attending a ceremony for the unveiling of the tombstone of his great-great-grandfather. A Catholic priest led the ceremony. I've never come across anything like this before. People don't erect new tombstones to their great-great-grandfathers. But Mugabe said, "It's important for the children of my clan to be shown sacred places. Just giving them oral history is not enough. They must be shown graves and other things." And that seems to me to be a movement towards materiality. Not enough to say my great-great-grandfather has a medium. Now he has to have a posh new grave. And as for the great spirits themselves, the Nahanda medium, who's the great heroine, people believe that she was hanged on a tree which still stands. She wasn't, in fact. She was hanged on the scaffold inside the colonial prison. But for a long period, belief in her spirit was enough. You didn't need to know where her grave was. Now the demand is that grave must be identified. We need, Zimbabweans need, to know where Nahanda's grave is. The whites know where Cecil Rhodes' grave is. We need to know where Nahanda's grave is. And an even more striking phenomenon was reported in the Sunday Mail in December under the title Chamanuka, the Resurrection. Now, this is the Chamanuka medium that we were watching in that film at lunchtime. 22 members of his family have gathered together. They went to Matabele land. They discovered, so they say, the body of the dead medium who was killed at Lobengula's orders in 1883. They exhumed the body of this medium and have carried him back for reburial at their sacred shrine. And there, at the sacred shrine, Chamanuka will be resurrected. I've never heard of this before. The exhumation of a medium and the carriage to a shrine. The shrine is under the authority of National Museums, which has said, we'll wait and see whether this is really a medium. And meanwhile, we'll do what we need to do to protect the site. The Sunday Mail says it looks as though there's going to be a clash between National Museums and the family. I think, therefore, that there are signs that there are real changes, not just in academic discourse, not just in the party's manipulation of dead heroes, but signs of real changes emphasizing body and materiality rather than spirit. And I end the paper with material that I won't go into in detail, showing that there's a similar issue in Kenya. A recent past and present collection on relics and bodies has a Kenyan article about the burial of Kimathi, or the failure to discover where he was buried. And the author of that article is asking, the interesting thing is, why do people now want to know? Kimathi's memory was enough in itself for long, long years. Now the demand is to have a body, just as the demand in Zimbabwe is increasingly to have a body. So I think that if I were to return, and people have been asking me the difficult question, if I had another 45 years to do research, what would I do? Should I go and search for bodies? I'm more likely to donate my own, I suppose, but I think I want to rethink my material in the light of these developments. It's a matter of striking a balance between my old view that bodies were important because spirit couldn't operate without them, and Fontaine's view that the spirit is important because bodies need it in order to be effective. Somewhere in the middle of those two propositions remains the truth about Zimbabwean religion. Thank you.
For those of you interested in asking our speaker a question, we have a microphone here, so please raise your hand and we can field a few questions.
Okay, all right.
Raise your hand if you would like to ask a question.
I was interested in what you were saying about the turn towards sites of memory, and particularly the kind of throwaway comment about, well, the whites know where Cecil Rhodes is.
Right.
Just very vaguely, what I remember reading about Mau Mau suggested that the colonial officials in Kenya were very afraid about kind of creating sites of memory and grave sites, and so I'm asking whether you would say that there's a big change, that before these discourses, these kind of areas were important in colonial discourse, but they didn't necessarily have such an impact to many people in Kenya or many people in Zimbabwe, and now there's more of an interest in these sites, and that's drawing comparisons with the way that maybe white people would look at graves and bodies, or colonial officials, post-colonial, would look at graves and bodies, but that it's not, that there's a change that wasn't understood as a change by colonial officials, that there's a danger that colonial officials were worried about that wasn't actually a danger to them.
Yes. When I sent a copy of this paper to my ex-student and now colleague David Maxwell, who's written extensively about Zimbabwean Christianity, he said to me, rather petulantly, I thought, for an ex-student, I kept on asking myself when you were going to mention Christianity, because I don't really, and there's a little bit towards the end which I skipped over. Now, the chap who's writing about Kamathi and the Kenyan example puts a tremendous emphasis upon Kikuyu Christianity. What he says was that in pre-colonial times, hardly anybody had a grave. I don't know whether this is true, but that's what he says. He says that when Kikuyu died, they were left in the bush. Now everybody has a grave. And that's partly because they're all Christians, and partly because the grave is a symbol of possession of the land, and claims to land have become so central. I ought to know, but I don't know, there are people in the audience who ought to know, whether this is true also of Zimbabwe, whether in Zimbabwe too, ordinary people weren't buried in graves. Chiefs tend to be buried in caves or in crevices in the rocks and so forth. But certainly if one was to bring in the dimension of Zimbabwean Christianity, then the corporeality of graves and so on, one would need to give a whole other lecture on that. What happened in the case of the colonial regime when they executed the Nahanda medium in 1898 was that, as you suggested in your question, they were very anxious that her grave should not be found. She was buried in an unmarked grave, and I've never come across any kind of evidence to suggest that that could be found. In the case of Kamathi, there was a most elaborate procedure whereby I think as many as 9 warders from that prison claimed to know where he was buried. And they had a government commission go there and they spent a day searching for what might be his body and they couldn't find it. So what they did instead was to erect a statue outside one of the biggest tourist hotels in Nairobi. There is a statue of Kamathi. And of course, there could have been a whole section of this lecture about statues, which occupy, you might say, an intermediate position between bodies and spirits. Zimbabwean government has difficulty with statues, actually. Not quite as difficult as with spirits, but nevertheless difficulty with statues. They just erected a statue of Joshua Nkomo in Bulawayo. They put him on the plinth where Cecil Rhodes' statue used to be. They had him looking east, just like Cecil Rhodes. But whereas people thought that Rhodes was looking to Cairo, people in Matabele land thought that Nkomo had been made to look towards Harare, and they didn't like that very much. Moreover, the statue was made by the North Koreans. Making statues is North Korea's major export industry. And the North Koreans had also trained the 5th Brigade, which had killed so many people in Matabele land. So the statue stood there. It was put under a black cloth. It was said Mugabe was going to come and unveil it. He didn't come. There it was under its black cloth. The family of Nkomo objected. And the statue has now been taken down and stands next to the old statue of Cecil Rhodes behind the museum in Bulawayo. So statues are not easy to control any more than spirits are. People get into a tremendous tangle with these kinds of symbols of history. I probably didn't understand you properly. You were asking me whether I thought it wasn't on the whole a good thing that people now are interested in graves. I don't see it as such, either a good thing or a bad thing. It's an alternative way of looking at it. Cecil Rhodes' grave in the Metopos that people still go to visit today actually was based by Rhodes himself upon the fact that he had discovered the grave of King Mzilikazi, the founder of the Indomaili state. Mzilikazi wasn't buried under a slab, but in a cave on the edge of the Metopos Mountains, looking out over the Lowveld. And during the 1896 negotiations that Rhodes was having with the Indomaili, some British soldiers broke into Mzilikazi's cave and disturbed it. Rhodes was very upset. He went there straight away. He had black cattle sacrificed. He went in to look at Mzilikazi because Cecil Rhodes had a thing about him and Mzilikazi being pretty much like each other. They would have been great mates and so on. And he also thought that Mzilikazi probably had a big head like Cecil Rhodes did. So he took Mzilikazi's skull out of the tomb, took it to the museum, had it measured, discovered that Mzilikazi had a very small head, and put it back in the cave again. Unfortunately, the Indomaili chiefs didn't know all that was going on. But Rhodes then changed his mind. He had originally said, I want to be buried at Great Zimbabwe. Now he said, no, I want to be buried in the Metopos. A much more sensible place to be buried. And that's why he's where he is. So it's very complicated, this question of, are Africans going to imitate Rhodes? Rhodes is, in a sense, imitating an African, you know? Very complicated.
It seems to me that concern for human remains is fairly common and, long-lasting. We see great interest in remains of veterans in this country, say, caught up in the Vietnam War. We see Bob Edgar's work to uncover the remains of a prophetess in Nontata and have her reburied. And we see a lot of interest around the world. So I'm wondering, maybe Joost was right in a more of a continuity of interest in, he was talking about graves, but maybe in human remains, and that maybe this is a case of the authorities in Zimbabwe just filling in another hole, or maybe it has a subtext, as you may be suggesting. But didn't Chendra Ihove also write a book quite some time ago called Bones?
He did.
So yeah. Was this an earlier cultural turn by the literary crew, or are the historians just catching up with them?
His next book was called Ancestors. So maybe he was moving in the other direction. Yes, well, both Joost and I are overstating our cases. I went to this remarkable lecture that he gave to the Royal Anthropological Institute in the bowels of the British Museum. And he was really overstating his case in saying that it's the graves that shape human lives rather than the opposite. Because the area that he's talking about around Great Zimbabwe was repopulated in the 18th century. And the only graves that are effective are graves subsequent to that time. Now, the whole area is riddled with previous graves. And they don't have any effect upon anybody because everybody's forgotten where they are. Graves are really dependent upon human beings rather than the other way around. They're only effective if you remember them as graves. So Joost is overstating his case. And you could accuse me, as people have, of romanticism with my emphasis upon the autonomy of spirit. I like to think of it like that. And since I've been thinking of it like that until I'm 81, I'll go on thinking of it like that.
Louise has just said this is like Oprah, so... Maybe not too much like Oprah, but I don't know. We're talking about graves and things. Just on a sideline on that question of Juice's position. In fact, I had a conversation with him after his paper in Oxford recently, where he said, "But if there's a grave on your land and you don't know that it's there, does it still have an effect?" And he for him that was an open question. So he's, you know, of course, one of the other graves that's there is the grave of Simon Bright's grandfather, who has his Absolutely. Whole spirit of his own. But what I want to talk about, Terry, is this fundamental incoherence about wanting to know where Nahanda's grave is, given that the person who's buried there is not Nahanda, but Chawe, the medium. And there's a kind of rewriting, it seems to me, in your account then, of the history, so that it is not, in fact, the Nahanda spirit, but somebody called Nahanda, who was a person, rather than a spirit medium. And then I'm thinking about what Arthur was saying to you all those years ago, and wondering whether there's a kind of turning away from some of these big spirit stories. But as you and I know from that event we went to at the Oxford Centre for Mission Studies recently, people are still extremely concerned about their family spirits, their ancestral spirits, and the difficult relationship that the churches have to those. But maybe there's a kind of, we want to present our history as more rational, even if we don't want to live our lives more rationally. And so we won't talk about Nahanda the spirit medium, we'll talk about Nahanda the person who has a grave, because that makes more sense in a kind of global discourse of history.
Well, of course, the same ambiguity arises with this exhumation of Chamanuka, because that was the Chamanuka medium that they're exhuming, rather than whoever Chamanuka was originally. And that's why I think that these events are remarkable, because they are unprecedented. In the research days that we had on Zimbabwean religion, we had a paper about Nahanda, and Rura Samai ventured the daring speculation that maybe the Nahanda mediums today are really mediums for revenge in Ngozi spirits. And it's not Nahanda, the great spirit of the Middle Ages, that's possessing them, that the infuriated medium who was hanged in 1898. Most Zimbabweans who were there were shocked to the core by this suggestion, either from a Christian perspective or a traditional perspective. But it's a very interesting suggestion. This is all very malleable, obviously, and it can be shaped and reshaped in many different ways. I just thought that those examples with which I finished were remarkable. I mean, they're remarkable because they're unprecedented. And whether they're really an indication of a tendency is another question. Another thing you could say is that all this has become very much a minority interest in the towns. And one can see this in a way in press reporting, that whenever there's a report about a powerful medium, the press handles it in a very clumsy sort of way. This medium the medium of the great Rojri emperor, Shangamiri Dongbo, who found diesel from the rock. Educated Zimbabweans were embarrassed by that, found it funny. The court went into session while she was being possessed. The magistrate ran out of the court because he didn't want to hear the spirit. There's a great tension between one kind of discourse and another kind of discourse. Here's your microphone.
The subtitle of your talk is about the subject of violence and immigrants. I was wondering if you had anything to say there was a relationship between the violent nature of the yes and the ways of war. Could you speak to that?
No, I didn't get the last part of the question. I'm sorry.
The subtext or title of your talk was about approaches to violence and memory. So I don't know if I missed it, but what, if any, would you argue was there, is there a relationship between the violent nature of these deaths, however recalled, and the way it's memorialized and the shift from spirit to body? Has it got anything you think was related to the violent nature?
It's true that I didn't say much about memory except by implication. For the Mugabe state, the kind of thing I was talking about, the hero's acres and the exhumations, are tremendously important as markers of nationalism and revolution and so on. Chief intellectual is a man called Mahosa, who writes every week in the Sunday Mail. And he emphasizes the central importance of Zimbabweans respecting the hero's acres, respecting the exhumed bodies. Even although Mugabe has just said that only members of his party will be buried in hero's acres, nevertheless, the opposition is expected to attend. And when the Government of National Unity was formed and they signed the protocols, one of the protocols that ZANU insisted on was one which said that everyone would respect national ceremonies. Now, Tsvangirai doesn't go to Hero's Acre. Recently, there was a funeral at Hero's Acre, and Tsvangirai went off and played golf. And that was outrageous. Mahoso denounced him for blasphemy in the Sunday Mail. Going to play golf rather than going to commemorate a dead hero. And what Mahoso's line on all this is very interesting. And he articulated it after the disconcerting elections of 2008. The legitimacy of this state doesn't depend upon the vote. The vote is merely the people's recognition of legitimacy. The legitimacy of the state depends upon the alliance of the ancestors and the guerrillas. And in typical Mahoso way, he says, even David Lamb recognized that, whereas that was the main thing that David Lamb was talking about. So the authenticity of this state depends upon the alliance of the spirit mediums, the ancestors, and the guerrillas. If people vote, well, that's nice, but that's just a recognition of that fact. And what frees the state from having to be authoritarian, if people didn't vote for us, we'd nevertheless have to continue to govern in the interest of the revolution. But what frees us from the need to be authoritarian is that we have these national rituals. And it's crucially important that people should continue to take those national rituals seriously. So that for someone like Mahoso, those things are absolutely crucial to what he calls long-term African memory. And he writes these long pieces about artificial Western memory, where things come to an end and they become heritage and you put them in museums. But African memory, where it goes on and on and on in the blood and in the bones. And so the past is incarnate in these national rituals. Very interesting stuff. Everybody thinks he's very boring, but I read him with trembling fingers every Sunday on my on my internet.
Okay, final question.
Is it on? Yes. Thank you so much, Terry. Maybe this is more of a comment. The beginning part of your talk where you were speaking about the spirit as a counterbalance to the to the power of the ruler. I'm thinking in a more visual age. Maybe the body is playing this a similar role. That there's a reason for it. But I'm wondering if, as a strategy, if in the long term it is quite as powerful as relying on the voice of the spirit.
Well, because my spirit is willing and my body is weak, I'll take that as a comment.